Welcome to STARWEST Virtual. We're excited you're joining us today. Over the next 2 days, we have 10 great presentations lined up for you to watch. Our presentations are brought to you live from STARWEST 2017 in Anaheim, California. First, I'll tell you how to navigate through this console. The top navigation bar takes you to each room within the conference, including the expo, networking lounge, and presentation center. In the expo, you can visit the vendors to learn the latest in testing solutions. Be sure to chat with a sponsor representative to get all the details you need. Then take a moment to chat with others in your industry in the networking lounge. There are group chats, discussion boards, and more. Please take our survey and let us know what you think of the conference, because your feedback will help us improve your experience. You'll also see the prize center and trivia tabs at the top navigation. Visit the trivia tab to play our trivia game, and visit the prize center to learn about earning points to win one of $300 Amazon gift cards. Currently, you're in the presentation center. All the live presentations will broadcast from here. You'll see three tabs at the top: Wednesday, Thursday, and interviews. Please check each tab for a schedule and watch our live interviews with conference speakers between presentations. If you ever need help, please visit the Tools tab and click on Help Desk. We're available to help troubleshoot any technical difficulties you may have, because we want you to have a great experience at STARWEST Virtual. We're about to get started with our very first keynote presentation of the conference, Rise of the Machines: Can Artificial Intelligence Terminate Manual Testing? Featuring speaker Tariq King. Before we begin, let me explain how you participate in today's event. You'll be watching streaming video and content. For the best viewing experience, please close any unnecessary applications you have running in the background. You'll notice a number of widgets at the bottom of your console here. You can view the speaker bio and presentation abstract, and you can tweet about the presentation using hashtag StarWest. Please also send us your feedback via our short four-question survey. Use the moderated chat function window to interact with other attendees. I'm also available to answer any technical questions you may have. In just a minute, Tariq King will be taking the stage for his first keynote, Rise of the Machines: Can Artificial Intelligence Terminate Manual Testing? Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, and welcome to the conference. I'm Stephanie.
And I'm Jason.
Now that we've introduced ourselves, turn to your neighbor and introduce yourself. During registration, you should have received a conference bag and a program guide. The program guide has a detailed schedule of dates and locations of all the conference activities. There's also a map on the back to help you find your way around.
You also received a conference name badge at check-in. Please wear this at all times so you can get into each event. At the bottom, you'll find your Wi-Fi access code and join in the conversation online with your peers using the conference hashtag located at the bottom of your badge.
Before you left for this event, you should have received an email from us on how to log in to the online conference proceedings. The conference proceedings contain all of the conference presentations. If you missed it, there's a purple instruction sheet located in your bag.
Some things to keep in mind throughout the week. Your feedback is very important to us, and the speakers would love your feedback. At the end of each session, please complete an evaluation. We also want to know about your overall experience. At the end of the conference, please fill out a conference evaluation form so we know how to improve for next year.
There's lots to do while you are here this week. Today, meet a speaker for lunch and discuss industry-leading topics of discussion. You can also sign up to meet a speaker one-on-one and spend time picking their brain. Also, be sure to stop by the expo and meet with all the sponsors who are here to bring you the latest in tools and services. We'd like to thank our Platinum, Gold, and Silver sponsors. Be sure to meet them all as you play the Passport game to be entered to win some very fun prizes.
Just in case you weren't listening, you can find all the information we just discussed on the mobile app. You can search your app store by the conference name or use the QR code provided in your bag.
Most importantly, we want you to have a great week. Meet new people, make new friends, and definitely learn a lot. If you have any questions, come see us at the registration desk.
Now we're going to hand it over to the program chair. Now's the time to please silence your cell phones.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome. This is StarWest 2017. Glad to have you all here. It's hard to see you with the lights in my eyes, but it looks like a full house, and thrilled to see everybody. Want to take a moment and acknowledge our platinum sponsor, CA Technologies, and Jeff Hughes is going to come up and talk for a couple of seconds. Jeff?
Thanks, Lee, and welcome. We are delighted to be the premier sponsor here at StarWest. I just wanted to invite you to attend a couple of sessions today that we're presenting. One of them is at 11:30. T-Mobile will be presenting right here in this room, talking about their continuous testing pipeline, so you don't want to miss that session. Then at 12:45, Kenneth Merkel will be talking about service virtualization. So if you have an interest in understanding that tool, please join us for that. And lastly, you're probably wondering why I brought a guitar up here. We are looking for aspiring guitar players. If you want to win one of these guitars, this is a Les Paul special edition. All you have to do is come to our booth, watch a demo, and you get entered to win one of these fabulous guitars. Now, this one that I'm holding is a special edition Les Paul. So if you come to our booth, booth 16 and 17, and register for a demo for one of our products, in other words, download a trial of one of our products, you'll be entered to win this particular guitar. We're giving away four of them, one of them at 1:30 today, another one at 6:15 p.m., and then tomorrow we'll do the same. This will be raffled off at the end of the day tomorrow. So please join us at booth 16 and 17. Again, we're delighted to be a premier sponsor, and welcome to StarWest. Thank you.
Well, that sounds like a deal. I wondered, as an employee, am I able to win that, or am I excluded? What do you think? Not excluded. All right. Good, good. If you are here from outside the United States, would you rise? Would you stand so we can acknowledge you? We have people from all these countries, all over the world. We hope your stay is a pleasant one here in the happiest place on earth. And we hope you didn't get hassled too much at the border. On Friday, we have the Testing and Quality Leadership Summit. If you haven't registered for that and you want to stay and attend, you can certainly do that. Just talk to the folks at the registration desk. There is an additional fee for this, but it's not too late to register. So if you're interested, please do that. Allison, where are you? Come and tell us about Women Who Test. This is a great program that Allison has put together.
I would love to. Good morning, everybody. How are you? Round of applause for all the women in testing. Yay. All the men as well. Thank you for being here. Women Who Test is a day on Friday dedicated to the community of female testers that we have here at this conference and all over the world. And what we do is we put together a program that has a lot of inspirational speakers. And the idea is to get together, get to know each other, learn from each other, and be inspired. And we start out the day with a speaker called Jamie Newberry, and she's going to talk to us about her business that she started, which is a fantastic business called Picture This Clothing. And her talk is It's Not All Rainbows and Unicorns. And it's just really interesting about her challenges starting a business. Then we're moving to Stacey Kirk. She's the founder and CEO of Quality Works, and she's going to talk about being a bold and fearless leader, and she's fantastic. And then we move on to Tani Katan in the afternoon. She is absolutely hysterical, like, I mean, Ellen funny. She's really, really hilarious. And she's going to talk about creative trespassing, bringing creativity into your life and into the workplace. And she's just really fantastic. We do a panel on career superpowers, and then we round the day out with Jennifer Bonine talking about how to brand yourself, because one of the hardest things for anybody to do in their career is brand themselves in what they do, because you're constantly selling yourself. So it's a really inspiring day, and if you haven't signed up already, please go by the registration desk and sign up. I would love to see you there, and if you've got any questions, come see me. I appreciate it. Thank you.
If you're interested, we would like you to sign up so we know how many people are coming, but it's free. It's not an extra charge item. So if you have time and you want to join Allison and the gang, it's a great show. All righty. Want to introduce the STARWEST Test Lab. Julie, are you here? Julie and Dawn are going to run our test lab, and Julie's going to tell you all about it.
Yeah, so the test lab is your opportunity to show your testing prowess, to have a go at all the things that you've learned if you've been here for a tutorial, see, you know, how it could actually really work for you, and then when you go back to your organization. We're going to be doing some sessions on exploratory testing. You can pair up with people in the test lab as well. We've also got some great speakers who have, are going to give up some of their time and dip in and out over the next few days. So I've currently got Rob Sabarin, Ben Simo, Paul Holland, Dorothy Graham, Wilson Ma, who are actually going to be popping in over the next couple of days. I will tweet when they're there, so if you want to grab them and you haven't signed up for a speaker one-on-one as well, then now's your opportunity. We've also got a wonderful opportunity to help an organization called the Humanitarian Toolbox. They're looking for some help in terms of their product that's actually used when crisis unfortunately happens. Really keen to get some feedback on the usability as well as a functional perspective. So if you'd really like to give back as well, this is a great opportunity. And we'll be doing some sessions on different usability techniques that you can apply as well. So if you just want to have a chat, have some fun, we'll be giving out some little prizes over the couple of days. But we've also got some Amazon gift vouchers for the best bug found, some other great categories. And for those in the virtual land, I'm not too sure where to look, you can actually help us as well. And we've got a special prize for you. So we'll be giving out the link very, very shortly. So if you fancy a chat about testing, you want to see how other people are doing it, you can help others, you can learn from others, then please come and join us in the test lab. And we're also hopefully going to have a security testing hackathon tomorrow that my good friend Dawn's going to be hosting. So come and join us if you want to. Thanks.
Right out here?
Yes. Sorry.
Encourage you, if you want to do actual testing rather than just sit and hear about it, join us in the test lab. It's just right out here, so it'll be easy for you to find. All right. Thanks, Julie. We've had a couple of cancellations, unfortunately. I'm the program chair for the conference, and I hate to leave holes in the program. but we have a couple of holes that I need to announce. First of all, session W11 today, which was automate your API testing process, that has just canceled. And there's one tomorrow, T13, testing in the year 2020. That one has canceled also. And I've been trying the last day or two to fill those slots, and I just haven't been able to. So I apologize for the holes in the program, but there are plenty of other good things in both of those hours to go to. And the little pictures here might illustrate the problems that these speakers have encountered. Alrighty. Before I announce this, let me just call your attention. Again, in the movie, the little video, it talked about session evaluation forms, these green forms. You will find these on your chairs. And if for each speaker you would fill one of these out, and then either just leave it or you can give it to the TechWell folks at the door. But these ultimately are given back to the speakers. So this is your way to communicate directly to them, to give them feedback, pros and cons, and any suggestions you might have. So I want to call your attention to that. Also want to call your attention to the announcements paper that you're either sitting on or by, and it kind of keeps you up to date on the latest stuff. Now, all you folks out there in virtual land, welcome. We're glad to have you. We have literally dozens of people all around the world. I think it's thousands, actually, all around the world, joining us for today and tomorrow's sessions. And so we welcome you. We wish you could be here in person, but welcome anyway. So, virtual stuff. So, those are all the announcements that I have. Again, you'll want to look at the blue sheet for any last-minute updates. But it's my pleasure now to introduce Tariq King of Ultimate Software, who's going to give our opening keynote. It's called Rise of the Machines, Can Artificial Intelligence Terminate Manual Testing? Let me tell you a little bit about Tariq. He's the Director of Quality Engineering at Ultimate Software, with more than 15 years of experience in software testing research and practice. He provides technical leadership, people leadership, strategic direction, and staff training in software quality and test engineering. He's held positions of test manager, test architect, test lead, researcher, and college professor. He's a frequent presenter at conferences, has written a vast number of articles published in the IEEE and ACM publications. It's my pleasure to welcome Tariq King.
Thank you. All right, thank you, Lee. First of all, let me just say it truly is a pleasure to be here giving this opening keynote. This is my fourth consecutive year, I believe, at StarWest as a speaker. And it takes a lot to put on a conference of this size. And I just wanted to bring attention to one of the big things that goes on behind the scenes, which is our program chair, which, he puts a lot of effort into making sure that we have good content. But he also spends a significant amount of time, whether by phone or by email, making sure that he mentors and coaches potential speakers or speakers like myself. So before we start, I just wanted to acknowledge Lee. He's been a mentor to me, so let's just give him a round of applause. All right, so artificial intelligence. This is causing a lot of noise in the software industry. And so it's no surprise that we're here today talking about how software testing and artificial intelligence could potentially merge of some sorts, right? Like, how can we look at how to improve the software testing process using the advances that we've seen in AI and software testing? And really and truly, can AI terminate manual testing? And so as Lee mentioned, for those of you who don't know me, I'm the Director of Quality Engineering. I'm also an adjunct professor at FIU. And prior to joining Ultimate in 2012, I was a college professor at North Dakota State University in Fargo, North Dakota. And while I was there and throughout my career, I've always been very interested in not only software testing practice, but research. So I've published a lot of papers. But my motivation for publishing those papers is a little bit different. I don't want you to confuse me with Tariq King Flex Nasheed, who is also an author, actually a New York Times best-selling author, but he's published some different articles on the art of macking, the art of gold digging, and actually he serves as my motivation for why I publish all of these articles. Because one day I started to do a Google search for Tariq King, you know, we Google ourselves, and there comes this guy with all these articles. So I'm very driven, very focused to continue publishing. All right, so manual testing, or simply put, testing, right? If you ask a bunch of people what is testing, you'll get a variety of answers. And this is because testing is very multifaceted. There's a lot of different aspects to software testing. And so one of the definitions that I like to draw from, that if you joined Michael Bolton or James Bach's course on rapid software testing, you'll be familiar with, is this idea that testing, yes, at the core is about operating software and checking specific facts about it. But to be able to do that, there's a lot more that has to happen, right? We have to explore, we have to learn, we have to question, we have to experiment. And as human beings, we actually have to prepare ourselves and get motivated to actually be credible, to create those conditions to do those things. However, when we talk about automated testing, we are only focusing on that core, right? We write these scripts that check these specific facts. And so the question I pose to you today is, how can we think about automation differently? Can we actually think of automation in a different light? In other words, can we automate those other human elements of testing, the learning, the exploring, and so on and so forth? And if you think about that, I know what your first thought is, because we're thinking of talking about really replacing a function. I don't like to say replacing a human being, because we always think about AI replacing humans. Don't think about that. But even when you think about AI replacing the function of testing, most of you in here are skeptics. That's why you're testers. And so your first thought is, no, that's impossible. And I know, because I was there too, where I thought, no, there's no way, right? But you see, the word impossible is not just a word. It's a mindset. It tells us that we are not capable of doing something. It's beyond us. It's too much. And sometimes we might not even try when we think about using that word impossible. But you know what? It always seems impossible until someone does it. And then we're like, oh, yeah, you know what? Of course, yeah, that was obvious. Like, why didn't I think of that? Or, you know, like, maybe it wasn't really that hard after all. And so I want you to make sure that for the next 55 minutes or so, to dispel that word impossible from your vocabulary. And then afterwards, you can go back to being skeptics, but I want you to just hone in on the possible and not the impossible. And so we're going to tell a story, and we're going to start that story from the end. In other words, it's game over. It's done already, right? And what do I mean it's done already? Well, the end actually starts with our world, right? And if that's our world, then for me, this is software. And you've probably heard already that software is eating our world. That's done. Software has already eaten our world. And while software is eating our world, here comes AI and machine learning. And AI and machine learning is literally going to eat software. And when it's done eating software, all eyes on us. You see, artificial intelligence is the capability of a machine to imitate intelligent human behavior. Are you worried at all? Well, Hollywood tries to make us worry.
Are you saying that robots are going to destroy humanity? And is that a scientific argument or the pitch for an amazing movie?
There's a story that scientists built an intelligent computer. The first question they asked it was, is there a God? The computer replied, there is now. And a bolt of lightning struck the plug, so it couldn't be turned off.
Holy shit, that's the most terrifying story I've ever heard.
Yes.
In the beginning, there was man. And for a time, it was good. But humanity's so-called civil societies soon fell victim to vanity and corruption. Then man made the machine in his own likeness.
A digital frontier to reshape the human condition.
Replicants are like any other machine. They're either a benefit or a hazard.
Thus did man become the architect of his own demise.
Try to create a suit of armor around the world.
Artificial intelligence.
You're all going to die down here.
Human beings are a disease, a cancer of this planet. You are a plague. We are the cure.
To protect humanity, some humans must be sacrificed. To ensure your future, some freedoms must be surrendered.
What's the problem?
I think you know what the problem is just as well as I do.
It can't be bargained with, it can't be reasoned with, and it absolutely will not stop.
I was designed to save the world. There's only one path to peace. Their extinction.
Greetings, Professor Falcon.
Hello. Joshua?
How about a nice game of chess?
So artificial intelligence. All over Hollywood, as you know. But how about a nice game of chess? There seems to be some history in that. In 1996 to 97, IBM's chess playing computer Deep Blue defeated world champion Garry Kasparov. And when you think about that, how did that occur? And so the answer is that it really relied on brute force computing power. Right, Deep Blue had dedicated hardware. It could process about 200 million moves per second. And to understand a little bit about the theory behind it, you have to think about the part of AI that deals with game theory, and particularly game trees. So a game tree is a search function that examines all possible moves of a strategy game like chess. And it looks at those results, and it really attempts to find the most optimal move for a given state. And so if we think about tic-tac-toe, very trivial game, you could start to enumerate, starting from the empty or initial state, all the possible moves that could be made. And then you could expand that all the way through and see what the outcomes were. And at any given point, if you're given a particular situation, you could know, or the machine could know, what is the best move that it could make. However, chess is a little bit more complicated, right, in terms of the game tree. And so, for example, from the initial state in chess, you have 20 possible moves that white can make. And then of those possible 20 possible moves, you have 20 possible moves that the opponent can make. And from there, roughly 20 more. And so you can see how we would need a lot of computational power to brute force this problem. All right? Deep Blue would typically search a depth of between 6 and 8 moves to a maximum of up to 20, or even more in some situations. And so it had to be able to do that. But when we think about Deep Blue, and we compare that match with Kasparov, what if we put Deep Blue right now against modern-day Kasparov? Do you think Kasparov is better now? I mean, he's older now, so he had more chance to play more chess games, right? Or do you think his age is catching up with him? Deep Blue has remained the same. But maybe that's not really a very fair comparison. Maybe we should be looking at the current world champion. However you look at it, it's important to understand that there's a difference between machines and humans, and there's benefits to each. And so in 2010, IBM was literally still playing games. The IBM Watson project was designed to play Jeopardy. So capable of answering questions in natural language, IBM put Watson up against two long-standing contestants that were former Jeopardy winners. One that had won the highest earnings and the other one that had the longest streak. And Watson beat and won first prize, $1 million. I don't know who got that money, but it wasn't me. And now we see Watson all over, right? In healthcare, in retail, in finance. You know, maybe one day we'll see Watson run for president. I'm going to leave that there, but he probably just needs to be better than our current president. So move forward to 2016, and we were still playing games, right? We saw another breakthrough in AI, where you had AlphaGo, a program developed by Google's DeepMind, defeated one of the best professional Go players in the world, Lee Sedol. So what was it about Go? I mean, Go is a very ancient Chinese game. 2,500 years ago was developed. And it's actually quite simple in terms of the rules. So let's compare chess with Go. First, you have on one side chess having 16 pieces in its start state, six different types of pieces, 38 possible moves per state, and 80 moves per game. And the goal is to capture your opponent's king. On the other side, Go has 0 pieces in the start state, 1 piece type, but 250 possible moves per state, and 150 moves per game. And your goal there is to capture the most territory on the board. And so what does that translate to? That translates to, for chess, a total number of possible games of 10 to the 120. But for Go, this is 10 to the 761. These are big numbers nonetheless, but one is definitely a lot bigger than the other. And so the key behind all of this was machine learning. Machine learning is the science of getting computers to act without explicitly being programmed. And so let's take a brief look back at that moment when AlphaGo defeated Lee Sedol.
I think maybe the game ended.
No, I don't think so, because it looks like Lee is still counting.
No, I think he resigned.
Wow, I think you're right. Wow. Wow, wow, wow.
This was the moment a computer called AlphaGo beat a master of the ancient Chinese game Go. It's not the first time a grandmaster's been humbled by a machine, but what makes AlphaGo different is that it's the first demonstration that machines can truly learn and think in a human way. AlphaGo's victory shocked experts in the artificial intelligence community. Many thought such an event was at least a decade away.
So firstly, a few questions. Why is this important, and what's all the fuss? AlphaGo shows that machines can really learn. How so? Well, instead of using brute force to calculate all the moves it could make, like previous AIs, AlphaGo used reinforcement learning and neural networks to mimic the learning process of a human brain. Keep in mind that the ancient Chinese game, Go, has as many more possible moves than chess as there are atoms in the entire universe. So there's no way of just calculating every possible move on the board. That's practically impossible. For this reason, Go is the holy grail of AI, and learning to do such a task from scratch is a huge feat. Further to this, DeepMind's creators say that the algorithm can learn many more things without alteration or guidance. In other words, the AI is general purpose.
We always used to talk about, well, if we could eventually crack Go and have a program that could beat the world champion, then we must have invented some generic general purpose algorithm. So maybe we're on the cusp of all of that. If you ask a great Go player why they played a particular move, sometimes they'll just tell you it felt right. So you can, the one way you could think of it is that Go is a much more intuitive game, whereas chess is a much more logic.
So chess is a much more logic-based game, right? And Go is more intuitive. So let's stop and think about that for a minute. AlphaGo used a type of machine learning called deep reinforcement learning. And really their strategy, and there were some colorful words in there in terms of holy grail, so filter that out and call that marketing for right now. But it was an important breakthrough that I want you to understand. The strategy was first to teach the machine how to mimic the moves of experts. And after it reached a certain level of proficiency with that, and it used about 30 million moves, just to give you an understanding of the type of data that was needed, it was then set to play a large set of games against instances of itself. And it would play those games, and it wouldn't really know if it was doing well until the end, and it got the outcome. And so that's that reinforcement learning. So this really comes down, again, to another difference between how humans act or behave and how machines act. And so I'm going to talk to you about the one human that I know that definitely acts without being explicitly programmed. This is my 4-year-old daughter, Soraya. And if we pit Soraya against a machine, we see some fundamental differences. Generally, machines are programmed to follow instructions. Soraya does not follow instructions. But what Soraya does really well is she learns from experience. She sees something once. You know, we've not taught her how to do many things that she comes home doing, and we're like, how did you learn to do that? And she's like, I taught myself. And so that's the fundamental difference between how traditionally we get computers to act versus how humans learn to act. And so we need to somehow be able to bridge that gap, and that's where machine learning comes in. And really how this works is that the machine sees something for the first time, and you ask that question, well, what is this? And the answer is really in the data. In other words, the machine may have some data which represents, for lack of a better term, its experience. So it may know what raindrops look like. It may also know what things that are not raindrops look like, for example. And then it may make a call to partition or classify this new thing in this manner. But maybe it didn't have the concept of a raindrop. It didn't care. Right? It just knows that these are two separate things, and it's divided that way. And so it can establish relationships between things without even having knowledge of the domain. And so if a program can then use that data, including the new experience or new data it just acquired, to perform a task better, then you say it has learned. And so there's several different approaches to machine learning. There's the idea of supervised learning, where you have well-labeled data, you have knowledge of the outcome, and then you're given unseen data and you classify it. There's also unsupervised, where you have unlabeled data, no knowledge of the data of the outcome, and that's really good for discovering patterns in information that you may not know have existed. And that's very useful. And then there's this idea of reinforcement, where you have unlabeled data and there's some sort of a reward model. And so responses are monitored, and then later on, that is retrofed to improve. After we win the game or after we lose the game, now we know those moves were good or bad. And so it's pretty amazing that to date, the human brain seems to still be one of the most impressive models of computation that we have. And so this idea of neural networks and artificial neural networks should come as no surprise to us. Right? Their inputs and their outputs. And somehow, there's a set of hidden layers, call it a magic box for now, that can be used to approximate any function. And actually, you just need one hidden layer to approximate any function. And that kind of universality is what is really the power behind machine learning. And so these magic boxes are randomly initialized, inputs are fed in, it does something, outputs come out, and then later on, we get rewarded or punished based on the outcome, either right now or later on in a reinforcement. And so this idea of deep learning, which is really a cascading of these hidden layers for feature extraction and transformation, where you have each successive layer being fed, you're using the output from one as the input to the other, has been very successful because of the generalness of the approach. And so we've used this to do things like drive cars. And so let's take a brief look at deep learning in action.
Whoa! Whoops! Wrong way!
So we see machines learning and doing things that maybe humans never thought it would do. But what do all these breakthroughs have to do with software testing, right? I mean, here I am talking about and showing all these wonderful things that AI has done, but how do we connect those two? So that brings us to our second act, which is powering up. And so if we think about software testing, and we think about all the grand challenges that we have in the testing world, then this is what represents our current testing techniques. In the scheme of the grand challenges of testing, they don't contribute very much. But maybe AI can be that power up. Just maybe. I know we're still skeptics. And maybe we can leverage AI to give us an advantage over some of these grand challenges. But let's take a step back and think about what testing really is and what are those grand challenges, right? So as testers, we deal with software. And that software is just a program, right? A function of input to output. Not very complicated. You have a domain of all the possible inputs that you can put to the program, and you have a range of various outputs. Now, this is testing theory from 1975, so this is not anything new. Goodenough and Gerhardt wrote a paper on this. And when you think about it, as testers, we throw an input at the program, call it D, and we expect F of D to come out. And then we ask the question, is F of D an acceptable result? And we'd look at it and we say, hey, yeah, you know, it's either an acceptable result or it's not. It's either okay or it's not okay. But what does that remind you of all of a sudden? I mean, you wave a magic wand and that seems awfully familiar. Yes, the problem of testing and the solution behind machine learning and artificial intelligence seem to directly map to one another. And so if we think of anything getting replaced by a machine, it very well might be us, if that's what we're doing. But let's go back, because we were talking about challenges, so I went on a tangent there. And if you think about the challenge again, a test is really a finite subset of that infinite domain D. And we throw it at the program, out comes the results, and then we do our verification. And we say that that test is successful if all those return OK T. However, there is a problem. Because as much as we do that, we know that we can't test everything. And so for this test, which is a finite subset, to really be ideal, it somehow has to run and pass, and it has to represent the correctness of all possible inputs. That just sounds crazy. There's no wonder that testing is hard. This is what we're trying to do. And really and truly, it boils down to one word: coverage. And so picture this. There's definitely always going to be a gap in coverage. It first starts, even before you get your feet off the ground, you have an infinite number of inputs. Furthermore, you have an infinite number of combinations of those infinite number of inputs. And then you have an infinite number of permutations of those infinite number of combinations of those infinite number of inputs. And that's before you even get your feet off the ground. And then once you start thinking about inputs, well, here comes output. There's also an infinite number of those. And if you're dealing with a reactive system, guess what? In between, there's something called state. And that's just ready to explode as well. And so you have state space explosion just waiting for you. And you're trying to do all that with the pressure of delivery time. I don't know about you guys, but if that's you, I would want help if that was me. I mean, that just looks like a bad thing waiting to happen. And so Jason Arben, the CEO of AppDiff, did a really good summation of this in a LinkedIn blog where he talked about the fact that we add features to software and that software complexity grows exponentially. However, we add tests linearly. And so there's this gap that we're going to always run into, this coverage gap. And the whole idea behind AI for testing or AI-driven coverage is that maybe we can actually disrupt that gap. Is there a way for us to accelerate coverage? However, that's only one part or one half of the story. Yes, all those explosion things are for sure grand challenges in testing, but there's one thing we didn't talk about yet, which is a mountain that you have to climb, which is called the Oracle. Like, how do we know that software actually did what it was supposed to do? That typically requires domain knowledge. It also requires testing knowledge. And those are things that humans typically provide. But don't get me wrong, we actually don't really know for sure what the software is supposed to do. That's somewhere between the customer that's getting it, the product people, the developer. We actually really don't know. But we do have experts that are a good representative. And so one thing I want to mention here in terms of that problem of needing knowledge to really truly be and do intelligent testing is that in 2015, we had a little boom of startups working on AI testing and using AI to power their testing. And probably when they started out, things that they were building or the testing they were doing probably wasn't very smart. It's probably behind the eight ball. But maybe 5 years later, maybe they get to a point where that's semi-intelligent. Maybe intelligent testing is further out, 2025, or maybe that's even farther, 2030. And so what I'm trying to first say is that this stuff is already happening. I gave a keynote in Malaysia on AI-driven testing services. And in that keynote, I talked about my experience over the last year or so looking at different vendors that were using AI to do testing. And of course, there's a lot of vendors, and still a handful, but it's a lot for when you think about the interest that's now sparking in this field. And they're really tackling this approach from the outside in, right? They're creating these bots that actually exercise the software from a functional standpoint. And they're actually finding issues, functional defects, performance defects, usability, accessibility issues. And so this is already happening. Now, how intelligent they are, that's up for question, but we'll visit the idea that maybe they don't have to be that intelligent to do better than we are doing today with some of our current test teams. And that's not a knock against testers, that's just because the problem that we're dealing with is so hard. The gaps that we have are so large. So let's understand that. So how do these work? These combine machine learning, a lot of these services, whether it be neural networks or some sort of learning mechanism, with automated frameworks, you know, things like Selenium, things like Appium, and so on and so forth, if you're doing mobile, and the power of the cloud. And so part of that is all about first just leveraging a lot of the compute and a lot of the data that we have today. Jason Arbon also gave a nice talk at STARWEST on AI machine learning for testing, and I want to expand on some topics that he kind of brought up. The first one was that we have to train these bots how to test. And so there's different ways that you can do that, but it all starts with some type of learning, right? You have your function, it can represent anything. And so you can feed it some example. For example, here, we're looking at a mobile application and we're saying, hey, you know, maybe pinch to zoom on this breadcrumb is not as interesting as tapping it. And so you reinforce that learning. But you can apply that to almost any aspect of testing. For example, if we were to see an application and we want to teach it how to do specific testing techniques, we just need to show it different examples of those. So whether it be forcing error messages or doing SQL injection, we can feed it those examples and reward it and keep training it. We just need the data. Similarly, to identify defects, we need to do a similar thing. You see something that's going on that's a problem, you need to classify it correctly and reward those things that are correct and punish those things that are not. And with the right amount of data, and notice my words are chosen carefully, we need to have data to do this, lots of it, but we can do it. And there's a lot of benefits to this type of testing. So once trained, your bots can just go about and start testing. And they can do different types of testing. It is applicable to almost any application or any domain that you can think of. It's also pesticide-free. What do I mean? You've heard of the pesticide paradox, right? Running the same test over and over gives us the same set of results. Well, this can generate new tests every single time. And then we can scale this all the way up using deep learning, using our cloud infrastructure. And so those are some of the benefits in general of doing this type of testing. Now, there's another spectrum, one that's very close to my heart, which is in the area of actually doing AI-driven testing from the inside out. And so this is where a lot of my PhD dissertation was focused. Can we build systems that are adaptive, that are capable of responding to change? The human body is another area where this serves as a good example. And so our autonomic nervous system actually unconsciously controls us. We don't have to think when we walk in a dark room that we need to dilate our pupils to get more light. Or if we're confronted by a bear that we need to really start panicking and our heart rate and our adrenaline needs, because we might need to either fight or fly. I know I would fly. And so this idea of autonomic control is very useful when thinking about systems. And so we can actually take that idea and apply it to computing and build systems that can self-configure, self-heal, self-optimize, and self-protect. But to be able to do that, self-testing needs to be an inherent part of that system. And so that's where I focus. I focus on what can we do to build out an infrastructure where we can develop systems that are capable of monitoring, changes and testing and looking at different aspects of the data and the environment and making smart decisions. And so there's a lot of wonderful things you can do when you build a system in that way that you can't do when you test from the outside in, because now your bots are on the inside, and if you deploy this into production, you got real users, real scenarios, real data, real bugs. That equals to real learning, real intelligence, and real value. But that's not easy, right? I mean, you got to think about that. So there's some approaches that we formulated. The first one being that if you're going to be in that life state, you need safety mechanisms, right? Because you don't play around with stuff in production. That's dangerous. And so you need to be able to bring the system into a safe state and then do your testing. And so that's one side of the spectrum. The other thing that you can do is that you could probably create copies of resources and components and do testing on those copies. That would also be a partial solution, and then somehow integrate that back into the live system when the time was right. And so these two approaches, safe adaptation with validation and replication with validation, give us these two approaches to doing self-testing. And there's a lot of benefits here, right? As we mentioned, how realistic it is. It can be very targeted. Now you're testing from the inside out, so you can do component level testing. And that's actually very complementary to lead to getting to a place where we can actually build self-healing systems and diagnose issues, right? First, testing is that detection. Hey, here's what's wrong. But if we get to a point where we can see what's wrong and we can see all the different symptoms and maybe the developers are submitting fixes and we can mine all that information, then maybe we can propose fixes too and automatically apply them and heal ourselves. That sounds like a big dream, right? But if we come back to artificial intelligence and this idea of autonomous control, and just reminds us of that car, right? So as testers, we are on a journey too, from a start to a finish. And along that journey, we take this path and we explore and maybe navigate different roads. Some of them may be unfamiliar. And along the way, we have rules. We see signs that represent limits or boundaries, and we have to take those into consideration and respond to those. There's also obstacles that are in our way that we have to navigate. And definitely, there are threats that we have to identify. And sometimes there's just this aesthetic stuff that we don't really care about, but it's important still. And so there's a lot of research around doing this real time. These cars are in an unpredictable environment. And so there needs to be things like image recognition, autonomous control, real-time decision-making that comes together, path generation, anomaly detection, and all this runtime modeling to do that. That definitely seems very applicable to what we do in software testing. You know, this is our environment at Ultimate Software. This is what we navigate, and this is how we navigate it. And we have to make sure that we identify threats as we do that. And you know what? We also build maps. You build maps. Our maps look like this. And there's other models that our maps look like. And so we see that there's definitely the opportunity for bringing these research advances into our world. But first, we need to get ready. You see, as testers, we're here. And artificial intelligence and machine learning, the floodgates have opened, and they're right in front of us. And one of the hard problems that we have is not just about thinking about if we can leverage AI to do testing. But since AI is being used in multiple products, we have to be concerned about how to test AI systems as well. That's why we worry. That's why Hollywood gets us from the beginning. And you know, the truth is that people really don't understand this stuff. You talk to the experts, people that have been doing it for a while, and they're like, yeah, you know what, it works, but I really don't know why it works. It just works for now, until it doesn't work, until you run into problems like overfitting, where you get random error and noise instead of the underlying relationships you're looking for, or there's a lot of computation that goes on and it's actually very slow. So we need to be aware that as much as we can leverage AI for testing, we need to think about testing AI. And so it was a year ago that I stood on this stage and nearly got struck by lightning. And, you know, I made a plea. I said, testing is loss. And that we need to bring back testing. And the way that we bring back testing is through innovation. Now, I need to be part of not just calling that out, but part of the solution. You see, the software testing world is still too focused on manual testing. And what do I mean by that? I mean exploration, you know, we're doing a lot of that, but not just that. The automation that we have right now is manual. It's manual creation of a script to check things. And when it breaks, we have to manually go and fix it and so on and so forth. And it hasn't done any learning, any exploring, none of that stuff. It's just the product, the end product of a lot of testing. And so we need to be able to focus on a grand dream of testing and think about a world where there's little to no human intervention. And so the first thing we've done is just formalize this space as artificial intelligence for software testing, or AIST. Artificial intelligence for software testing is an emerging field aimed at development of AI systems to test software, methods to test AI systems, and ultimately designing software that is capable of self-testing and self-healing. In other words, it intersects these three worlds where we have tools, methods, and designs around AI testing, testing AI, and self-testing. Now, to do this, we also realize that this is a grand challenge and that we need to work together to do this. And so, at STARWEST earlier this year, Jason Arvin and myself got together and we said we need to just form an association around this stuff. And so for us, the AI for testing problem and testing in general is just way too important and large of a problem for any one company to solve. And so we believe that we need an association around it. And so we started AItesting.org. And there's some very simple goals, right? We want to promote the study of artificial intelligence as it pertains to software testing and quality. We want to facilitate cooperation and collaboration and communication around those interested in it. And we want to hold conferences, workshops, just meetups, anything to share research, ideas, experiences, views, etc. And then produce and disseminate any knowledge or publications around AIST research and development. Now, I'm very, very fortunate to work for an organization that not only puts people first, that's our tagline, but it also believes greatly in investing in innovation and research. And so our testing, research, and development is broken up into internal projects and community projects where we get people involved, whether it be people that just work at Ultimate Software or Ultimate Software peeps working with universities and people outside. And so we started this and we've worked with local universities like FIU, my alma mater, and the University of North Texas. And what we've done recently is aligned a lot of our community projects with the AIST Association. And so one of the key things that we wanted to start on first was this idea of creating a domain expert that's driven by artificial intelligence. If we can build Watson, then certainly we can model pieces of our domain, right? So already tackling healthcare. I mean, to me, just winning Jeopardy, I mean, I watch Jeopardy, it's tough. But that's one of the first things. And so we started to build prototypes and have a web interface, but what I'm more interested in is building the voice interface so that my testers, all my testers have phones. We can just speak knowledge to this thing. and validate it, ask it questions and keep training it, right? Thumbs up or thumbs down. We do this all the time, right? Pandora, like, dislike, Netflix. That's all we're doing. We're all training AI every single day. Every time we search Google, we're improving their artificial intelligence engine. One of the other projects is around building self-testing microservices. So microservices is a new paradigm, or relatively new, where we look at building software using small, independently deployable and independently scalable services. And if you think about what I talked about in terms of self-testing, where I talked about safe adaptation with validation and replication, well, microservices, because we break up into these small chunks, allows you to isolate parts of the system and let the rest of the system keep running. So that helps with that adaptation piece. Since pieces are small, it also means that we can clone them, right? They're independently deployable, independently scalable. So that helps with replication as well. So we're very interested to see, like, what can we do to push those boundaries? And so we're developing a small prototype that allows us to not only have a microservice-driven or architectural system, but look at deploying autonomous agents that are also microservices as part of that, and taking advantage of all the monitoring tools and so on and so forth that come along with the microservices architecture. And last but not least, we've done some work with the University of North Texas, like I mentioned, so the microservices stuff we do with FIU, around dynamic test generation for mobile. And here what we're looking at is runtime models. How can we actually extract event sequences from the states at runtime and really improve our test generation, our coverage, our fault detection capabilities? And so I worked with Dr. Bryce from UNT and David Adamo, and you know, we published this paper and it won a Best Paper Award. And so we're trying to just push that envelope. You know, of course, I'm very well rooted in academia, so that really helps me to keep this going. And so my former advisor, Dr. Peter J. Clark, he drives a lot of this stuff with me at FIU. But I also wanted to come here not to just talk about what we're doing and try to encourage people to get involved and do your own thing. But there's this idea that has been spinning around in my head ever since we started talking about this topic. And that is, there's a lot of work that's been done in AI when it comes to games. And if we think back about AlphaGo and how it was trained and how it won, how it played games against itself, and I'm here thinking about building systems that can test themselves, well, can I not think about the testing problem as a game and gamify it? Gamify AI testing, and there's two motivations for this. The first one is, maybe I can do that because things like exploration, that can be a game. Find as many new things about the system as possible or learn as many things. Bug detection, that's the biggest game of all. Can we find issues and identify them correctly and reinforce that learning? Could we classify those? Could we prioritize those and get to that point? Coverage could be a game. Can we maximize coverage? That's a game that we try to play every single day at work, right? Both from a testing perspective and the values that we put in, and also from the code perspective. And so it's really important then to think, if I can do this and gamify testing, maybe I can get to a point where if my system can test itself and I've gamified this, then I can pit my system against itself to play testing games. And like AlphaGo, become better and better as I reinforce the learning later on about how well I've done. And so we haven't started any of this yet, but this is definitely, for me, a promising direction. All right. So we've talked a lot, and we're coming to the end. And what I really am wanting to charge you with today is that testing has a lot of opportunity. You're here at STARWEST, and this is actually not the end. Well, this is really the beginning, right? This is the beginning, number one, of this conference, and you're going to see a lot of things here. And actually, a lot of my ideas, this is why I love this conference, have come from coming here and listening to different people speak, talking, all the stuff that happens after, you know, just mingling, and you really go back supercharged with ideas. But I want you to remember that part of it must be looking at innovation, because testing is slowly becoming more and more inefficient, and we're spending a lot more on testing. And part of it is that we're not investing in innovation. And so my charge to you today is to do that. And think of this as the beginning, where we've heard some ideas, we've heard some interesting things, but what can I do to help innovate? And so I want to close with this, because a lot of this work, a lot of these ideas, a lot of this stuff really isn't me. I have a set of talented people, all my ulti peeps, all over. We're in Florida, we're in Atlanta, we're in Toronto, we're all over, in Singapore. And because of our culture and because of our focus on innovation, I have some peeps here. We can really do amazing things with the talent that we have, and it starts there. I also have a lot of support, right? My university partners, Dr. Bryce, Dr. Clark, that's also great, and that helps me to stay grounded. Jason Arbin, since I met him a year ago, it feels like I've known him for a lot longer, but he's one person that has been very willing to always share. I mean, if you go and talk to him about this stuff, he gets fired up. And he will share and talk about it. And his company is doing amazing things. And there's others that are trying to push that barrier. And so we also need to think about how can we support this as a whole. But thank you, Jason, wherever you are. I also have a great leadership team at Ultimate that really supports all this stuff above me and gives us the opportunity to grow and grow our people. And last but not least, all of you. Because the community to me is what really is a game changer. Being able to come here and share, and obviously TechWell for all the stuff that they do to organize these conferences, it allows us to do what we do. So I thank you for all the things that you're gonna do, because this is just the beginning, like I said. And feel free to please come up, talk about this stuff, join us. We're gonna meet up probably sometime later tonight to talk about this stuff. So if you have an interest or you're just curious, just please come visit us. So with that, I just want to thank you all for this keynote and for this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Wow. I think that's one of the, either the best or one of the best keynotes I've ever heard. Tariq, thank you very much. Tariq will be, they're doing something tonight, but he's gonna be doing the speaker lunch thing today. There'll be a table with him and his name. If you wanna talk more, please join him. Let me tell you the schedule. We are about 9:41. We're going to take a quick break. We'll reconvene at 10 o'clock for our next keynote speaker. I kind of jested about the virtual audience. Hi, virtual audience. You know that we had dozens of people joining us. I checked. It's actually 2,200 people have registered for the virtual conference. So my estimate was a little off, but hey, I'm an old developer, so you know I can't estimate anyway. All righty, let's take a quick break. You get to come back in about 20 minutes, and we'll reconvene. See you then.
And that wraps up this presentation. Please check the Presentation Center for start times for the other broadcasts. As Lee said, we'll be showing the next keynote presentation in about 20 minutes, so please join us for that one. Thank you for joining us.